Okay, well, let's start with the Delta City Blues. If you end up happy with the performance and we use it, we'll use this part. If not, forget it. Of course, nobody ever hears my questions.
Right.
So you can just start by saying, if Delta City Blues is important to you or you like it or whatever it is about it.
That's okay. Special. Oh, that's what I was looking for. Where did you find these? Thank you. Do you mind if I wear them? Is that okay?
Hold on, let's see.
Is it going to boring? Is that okay?
Well, I'll tell you what. You can wear them if you want.
Yeah.
I think it's people like to see people's eyes, and it makes it a little more personal. And
okay. I don't care either way. I just didn't want to lose them.
Okay.
Should I look at you or the camera?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Delta City Blues came as it was actually an exercise that I was practicing on the saxophone one day, and it just kind of fell right into my lap. It's one of those things that just appeared as I was playing. I said, oh. And I wrote it out quickly, and then proceeded to make a tune out of it. And it's a lot of fun to play. My wife came up with the title Delta City Blues. As usual, I couldn't think of a title, but it is based on kind of a New Orleans sort of a groove, and it works on uses the overtone series on the saxophone, which is a part of the saxophone that you don't hear too often, so I managed to work that into a song, and we have a lot of fun playing it every night.
I want to ask a little bit about Newport. Is there any special? You've been up to Newport a lot of times.
Yeah.
Is there any particular memory moment, something really fun or notable in some reason, a particular Newport memory that comes to mind?
Well, a Newport memory, I've played here many times, but a particular Newport memory that comes to mind for me, just a personal memory, was when I played here with McCoy Tyner 2 years ago. And it was just a beautiful day, and just the music just flowed, and it was a wonderful audience, and we really had a good time. And for some reason, that really just sticks out. Of course, for me, it was always a great pleasure playing with McCoy, a great thrill. And being at Newport and just on this beautiful day, and it sticks out in my mind. There's been a lot of great memories here.
Is there something about the vibe or the feeling that is particularly attractive to artists such as yourself?
Well, the setting, I think, is what creates some of the magic at Newport. It's just so beautiful. When you look out and see the boats and, people, just the whole panorama. And it's just such a long-standing tradition. This festival is one of the first festivals. So it holds a place of warmth in all of our hearts. It's fun to come here.
Can you tell me a little bit about your band, how you chose the individual members and why, and what you look for when you put the band together?
Sure. Starting with Joey Caldarazzo, the fine pianist who I've been playing with for many years, I met Joey when he was a student at a university, Long Island University, and I went there to do a clinic and teach, and he was the pianist provided for me, and I grabbed him. I said, oh, I want that. We've been together ever since. He was 21 years old at the time, and I was playing with Kenny Kirkland, who I knew was going to go back with Sting at any moment, so I kept Joey right on the sidelines, and when Kenny left to go back with Sting, I hired Joey immediately. And we've been playing together a long time, and we have a special chemistry. He's a just fantastic pianist and musician, and we're like brothers. We complement each other really well. Jeff Tane Watts is, I can't say enough about him. He's just, one of the great drummers of all time, the thing that's attractive and interesting about him, aside from the fact, he has that, deep sense of swing, is that he has the ability to maintain a conversation musically at all times. In addition to the swing, he plays on many levels at once, and it's almost like playing with a three-dimensional drummer. So it's always, a great experience playing with him. James Genus just can do anything on the bass. Has great sound, great pulse, and is, really is the bass player's bassist.
Very good. I like those analysts. Those are very good comments about all of them. I like the story about Joey.
Yeah.
Is there another I asked you about Delta City Blues. Is there another tune that's important to you that you'd like to talk about a little bit? Or how you came about choosing your set?
Hello. Well, the set seems to change every night. And we chose this particular set today just to, we felt that we could possibly fit it in an hour. Usually we play, you know, a bit longer, or quite a bit longer, actually. And we tried to be somewhat concise today and see if we could squeeze it in. And, you know, we change up a lot. And it is jazz and it's improvised, so it, you know, the tunes change every night as well, and or every day. And yeah, I think that kind of sums it up.
Michael, I know you're in a hurry, so I'm just going to keep it short, but I also want to give you an opportunity to, if anything else has occurred to you, things that are, like, do you like to talk about education or promoting jazz or what's going on in the field, or, you know, particular musicians that inspire you?
I come from a musical family. My dad, Robert, was a semi-professional pianist and an attorney. More of an attorney than a pianist, but he played really well. So we grew up listening to music. There were three children. My brother Randy, who I'm sure you're very, very familiar with, is a fantastic trumpet player. And I have a sister, Emily, who's a pianist, and we grew up from a very early age playing instruments. We had jam sessions at home, and I think by the time I was 13 or 14, I had already heard, my dad took me, instead of taking us to the baseball game or to the football game, we went and heard live jazz concerts. So by the time I was 13, I had already heard Miles a couple of times, Miles Davis, I had heard Thelonious Monk, Dave Brubeck, Duke Ellington, Woody Herman's band, Count Basie band, on and on and on. I can continue on. You know, and I have a lot of fun memories of these concerts. And, you know, those are really kind of my roots as far as music. I remember my father sitting, we were sitting in a concert before Thelonious Monk was about to come out and play. It was a night where we were hearing a bunch of different pianists. And Thelonious was about to come on stage, and my dad leaned over to me, and I must have been 11 or 12, 11 years old maybe, and he said that Thelonious could make sounds come out of the piano, create sounds on the piano that nobody else could. You know, and I thought that he meant that, you know, he could make a piano sound like a chicken, or I had no idea what he was talking about. But when I sat and then listened to Monk from that perspective, I could hear it, you know. And so those were important lessons for me, and
that become a part of your music, hearing those kinds of things like Monk, for instance?
Yeah, I think that has become a part of my music. Really, there was always jazz in the house. My earliest memories are memories of Clifford Brown, Miles Davis, again, Dave Brubeck. And I really thought, when I was a kid, I thought everybody was a musician. People that came over the house always jammed. You know, and so we took up instruments at a really young age. You know, when it became my turn to play something, I chose the clarinet because I liked the way it looked. And I just thought this is what everybody does. You know, and I later learned that it wasn't so common. And it was almost kind of a reverse, you know, family, in reverse musical family. You know, where normally parents encourage their kids to, you know, to learn music, but then when it comes time to get a real job, you know, they try and, you know, give them a light push in another direction. And in our case, we were encouraged, you know, to be musicians. You know, we were encouraged to do whatever we wanted, you know, whatever we liked. But we ended up liking music, so we were supported for that.
That's really good. I like that whole little story that you just told. Great. Michael, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.